You're watching Tag TV.
Hello and welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about the breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. Terrorists launched serial grenade attacks in Kashmir. Pakistan exploiting religious sentiments to incite separatist violence in India. Islamabad not acting against terrorist groups, says US State Department report. And Hafiz Saeed influencing judicial orders in Pakistan. Pakistan-backed terror outfits continue to create mayhem in India's Jammu and Kashmir since the abrogation of Article 370 in the region. Recently, the valley was rocked by severe terror attacks that caused heavy casualties and turmoil in the region, a report. The Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir continues to remain tense as Pakistan-backed terror outfits are constantly carrying out attacks in different parts of the region. Recently, a grenade attack was launched by terrorists in the main city of Srinagar, leaving at least one dead and 45 injured. The injured, including three Indian paramilitary police, were admitted to hospital after the blast in critical condition. The incident came just a week after at least 20 people were injured in another terror attack when militants lobbed a grenade at a bus stand near a busy market in Sopore town of North Kashmir. These terrorist attacks are meant not only to cause large-scale damage to life and property, but also to create an atmosphere of fear and terror among the people of Jammu and Kashmir.
Pakistan is absolutely desperate to project Kashmir as an international flashpoint. Much that it wants to do so, Kashmir is fast returning towards normalcy. Pakistan tries to push in terrorists on a daily basis through 8 to 10 ceasefire violations. However, by and large, Pakistan's all attempts are turning out towards a failure. Terrorists within the valley have been eliminated to the extent of about 80%. The leadership has been destroyed. Morale and motivation has fallen, which is a huge cause of concern and worry for Pakistan. Under these circumstances, Pakistan continues to make various methods of attacking people in Jammu and Kashmir, either attacking the migrants or trying to attack the tourists, so as to ensure that Kashmir remains in the limelight internationally.
Security forces in the valley continue to fight Pakistan-backed terrorists who have infiltrated into Jammu and Kashmir. During the ongoing investigations of these attacks, security forces apprehended a terrorist, Danish Tariq Channa, belonging to Lashkar-e-Toyba. Loads of arms and ammunitions, including pistols, 7 rounds and a grenade, recovered from him were seized by police. Several reports have confirmed that Pakistan consistently funds these terror outfits to carry out unprecedented attacks to disrupt peace and harmony in the Kashmir Valley. Danish Channa is the latest example displaying the Pakistan's malicious agenda against India. Lashkar-e-Toyba is a Pakistan-based terror outfit which is responsible for a series of terror attacks in India.
It is the money that makes the mayor run. And if there is no money, obviously all these activities will come to a standstill. There are very many methods through which Pakistan is collecting funds and siphoning it off to people in the valley. One is through the Pakistani sources itself. Second is through the Pakistani aided business community, both in Old Delhi as well as Jammu and Kashmir. Third is through Hawala. Fourth is through direct remittances by the Pakistani diaspora, which is spread all over the world, particularly in the Middle East. And fifthly, through cross-border trade, which has now been stopped. These were the major sources through which our funds were being sent. As far as arms and ammunition is concerned, one is through Punjab, Nepal and Bangladesh borders. Second is, of late, they've started sending arms and ammunition through GPS-assisted drones. If you notice, in the last 10 days, there have been almost 8 droppings done in various parts of Punjab by drones, which were meant to be siphoned off to Kashmir.
Rattled by the revocation of temporary special status of Jammu and Kashmir, Pakistan is leaving no stone unturned to infiltrate terrorists into Indian territory to carry out attacks in the region. Sources from the Indian government say that Pakistan Army has issued detailed instructions to terrorists operating close to the line of control to wear military uniforms to avoid getting caught by the international community. Above and beyond, the Pakistan Army senior officials have also been given instructions at the top level to ensure that the instructions are observed and carried out properly by terror groups on the ground.
Pakistan is extremely worried. Every time they make any attempt to do damage to India, they invariably get caught in the act. And India has been telling the world that situation in Kashmir is absolutely normal, but for the fact that it is Pakistani-initiated, Pakistani-inspired terrorism. So Pakistan wants to hide the fact that Pakistan is involved. They want to show to the world that it is the people within the valley who is revolting against the Indian forces. That unfortunately is not so. So to hide their activities, they are now telling people to wear the army uniforms so that they appear as military personnel or personnel who are actually revolting against the Indian nation. I am very certain the world is wise enough to understand Pakistan's ruses and Pakistan's attempts to hide who actually is behind this. The government of India has very categorically told Pakistan there is zero tolerance for terrorism. At any point of time they inflict damage to India, we will give a very heavy punishment to Pakistan.
While the situation in Jammu and Kashmir is returning back to normalcy, Pakistan has intensified its efforts at increasing the strength of terrorists in launch pads along the line of control to create havoc in the region. Such consistent attempts of Pakistan at fomenting trouble and breaching harmony in an otherwise peaceful Kashmir reek of its duplicity. Gurdwara Nankana Sahib in Pakistan Kartarpur corridor is of immense spiritual significance to Sikh community, but Pakistan has stooped so low that it is using the auspicious occasion of opening of the corridor as an opportunity to promote anti-India movements. A recently released promotional video of the Kartarpur corridor by Pakistan features Khalistani militants who were killed during the Operation Blue Star to flush out terrorists in June 1984. We bring you a report.
The opening of Kartarpur corridor, a border corridor between India and Pakistan connecting the Sikh shrines of Dera Baba Nanak Sahib and Gurdwara Darbar Sahib, is welcomed by the Sikhs. It is predicted that the corridor will help in easing tensions between the two countries. Days before the opening of corridor on November 9th, a promotional video released by Pakistan is gaining traction from everywhere for featuring pictures of 3 slain Khalistani separatist leaders. The video on official Twitter handle of Pakistan government features posters of Khalistani militants Janel Singh Bhindranwale, Amrik Singh Khalsa and former Major General Shabek Singh.
On one side, Pakistan is opening the Kartarpur corridor, which is a welcome step. On the other side, he is promoting the terror activities too. The both things cannot go really side by side. Recently, a video was released in which former terrorists and supporters of Khalistan were also seen. So this is contrary to what we believe, that Pakistan has got only religious angle here in opening of the Kartarpur corridor. Pakistan has always has a hidden agenda behind everything whenever he talks peace. This is a good gesture on 515th birth anniversary of Sri Guru Nanak Dev Ji. But if Pakistan misuses it, it is a very bad on their part. Releasing of such a video is only creating friction between the two communities and the two countries, which should have been avoided.
Islamabad has been unrelenting in its support to the anti-India elements. It has not only been financing secessionist endeavors, but is also giving them access to its land to devise their sinister strategies. Sikhs for Justice, now a banned organization by India, has been at the forefront of propagating anti-India sentiments. Supported and funded by the ISI, Sikhs for Justice has been carrying out referendum 2020 campaigns across Europe, but its attempts are failing miserably, which is making both SFJ as well as Islamabad desperate to try new methods.
There is nothing new of Pakistan using religious sentiments to exploit the terror angle. They have been doing it in the past. They have tried it in the UK also. They have tried in other countries also. They will continue to do that. But that does not deter us from opening new peace avenues and watching them, giving them a chance. That is what our system is designed, our democracy is based on. We always welcome the peaceful moves. Like Imran Khan has shown his determination in opening this corridor, we also welcome it. But the backdoor angle which security agencies are looking at, that some terrorists are being trained, something there are camps around the Kartarpur Sahib Gurdwara, they cannot be untrue, because they will have definitely some information, and it is a well-known fact that Pakistan have camps of terrorists here and there, especially in the POK and near the pilgrim centers where Indian pilgrims are going in the past also.
Pakistan's spy agency, the Inter-Services Intelligence, has remained on a constant lookout to leverage the Kartarpur corridor for propagating anti-India separatist movements. Captain Amrinder Singh, the Chief Minister of India's Punjab state, has issued several warnings against Pakistan's ISI, asserting that India cannot afford to ignore the ISI threat that is attached to opening up of the Holy Corridor. It is imperative for India to be cautious, as the mischievous agency certainly has negative agendas behind it. Indian state of Punjab has already suffered over a decade-long militancy during the 1980s and early 90s, when Pakistan supported Sikh separatists to raise a demand for Khalistan, an independent state for the Sikhs.
The United States has once again slammed Pakistan for not acting against terrorist groups, including Lashkar-e-Toyba and Jaish-e-Mohammed, which continues to operate from its soil and also raise funds from the country. Country Reports on Terrorism 2018, a latest report by the United States, has reinstated the fact that India continues to remain the target by Pakistan-based terrorist organizations. A report.
The U.S. State Department's Country Reports on Terrorism 2018 published this week states that the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed continue to be a threat to India, and slammed Pakistan for allowing candidates affiliated with the LAT front organizations to contest the country's last general elections. Reinstating Pakistan's failure in implementing Financial Action Task Force's recommendations, the report further states that the authority from Pakistan have failed miserably to uniformly implement the Financial Action Task Force plan on money laundering and counter-terrorism.
Despite the global shame and humiliation Pakistan has to face on the aspect of terrorism, it still continues to adopt terrorism as an instrument of state policy. And hence, it supports not only breeding terrorists, but training and financing them as well. And as far as Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed are concerned, they are India-specific terror groups which Pakistan is harboring, and Pakistan treats them as strategic assets and as an appendage of the Pakistan Army to carry forward the mission of the Pakistan Army of bleeding India through 1,000 cuts. So therefore, the support of Pakistan's establishment to Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed is not surprising.
Regionally focused terrorist groups also remained a threat in 2018. For example, Pakistan-based Lashkar-e-Taiba, which was responsible for the 2008 Mumbai attacks, and Jaish-e-Mohammed maintained the capability and intent to attack Indian and Afghan targets. In February 2018, operatives reportedly affiliated with JEM attacked an Indian Army camp at Sanjwan in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, killing 7, says the report. The Lashkar and the Jaish were responsible for a series of terror attacks in India that include attack on Parliament, leading to death of scores of innocent people and security personnel. The US State Department confirms in its report that the Pakistan government has failed to significantly limit the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed from raising money, recruiting and training in Pakistan. The report specifically criticizes Pakistan for allowing candidates overtly affiliated with the LET front organizations to contest the July 2018 general elections.
Pakistan has been trying to tell the world that it is trying to mainstream the terrorists. It's a funny way of getting terrorists into mainstream without disarming them. There have been many instances in the past in many countries of the world where they have tried this and failed miserably. But Pakistan fails to learn from their experiment and insists on bringing the leaders of these terror groups into mainstream through contesting elections without disarming their respective cadres. It is going to create havoc in Pakistan. Pakistan must realize that these same very terror groups, the leaders, when they join the mainstream, they would only promote terrorism and not nationalism. And that's the time Pakistan will realize that what grave mistake they have done by promoting them or by bringing them into the mainstream. But that's the only excuse they can give to America. And the Americans have to accept it because Americans prefer democracy.
Focusing on internal threats in Pakistan, the report also says that Pakistan experienced significant terrorist threats in 2018. The major terrorist groups that focused on conducting attacks in the country include Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan, Jamaat-ul-Ahrar Islamic State's Khorasan province, and the sectarian group Lashkar-e-Jangvi-al-Alami. ISIS of Khorasan province claimed several major attacks against Pakistani targets, some of which may have been conducted on collaboration with other terrorist groups.
When you breed snakes in your backyards, they'll definitely bite you one day. And that is what is happening in Pakistan. Pakistan has got so deeply involved in this industry of terror that it's now feeling the heat of it. But then it cannot get out of it or cannot get away from it, because today the terrorists or the militants form part of the government. The government in Pakistan is being controlled by the trio of militants, military and the mullahs. Therefore, whatever civil government is there is for the namesake. Imran Khan is the Prime Minister of Pakistan for namesake. He is being dictated terms by this trio. So therefore, it's very difficult for people like Imran Khan or his government to curb the homegrown terror in Pakistan.
According to the US State Department report, Pakistan criminalizes terrorist financing through the Anti-Terrorism Act, but implementation remains uneven. Recently, in its plenary session in Paris, the FATF continued Pakistan's stay in grey list till February 2020, citing concerns over Pakistan's failure to fully implement the UN Security Council, ISIL, and Al-Qaeda sanctions regime. FATF has been constantly noting that UN-listed entities, including Lashkar-e-Taiba and its affiliates, are not being effectively prohibited from raising funds in Pakistan or are being denied financial services in the country.
Pakistan is a terror breeding country with mountain level double standards, which functions at the commands of terror warlords. The Global Desk has enough on its table to substantiate this statement. Adding a point to its diary of terror data, a latest incident in Pakistan has drawn eyeballs from all across the world. The incident that showcases Hafiz Saeed's supreme powers in Islamabad affairs exposes Pakistan's dubious techniques of treating terror leaders who, although have been lodged behind bars, but are exercising complete control over all the state machineries, including the judiciary. A report.
A Pakistani court acquitted all three police officials accused of killing an ATM thief in police custody after UN-designated terrorist Hafiz Saeed played the role of an arbitrator in it. This is one among those various incidents that display Hafiz Saeed's tall stature in the functioning of state machineries of Pakistan. Saeed, who has been in the high-security Kot Lakhpat jail, has been playing an active role in state-related issues.
Pakistan is sponsoring its terrorism. Now, to sponsor terrorists and terrorism, what do they require? There are three basic requirements. You require manpower, you require human beings. You require the means to train them. Somebody has to train them. And you require money. So all these three things, how are they being done? As far as training is concerned, the Pakistani army is training them. They're trained soldiers, they're training these terrorists. Manpower that is required, human beings that are required, and the funding that is required, who's doing that? That is being done by these locals, people like Hafiz Saeed, Afzal Guru. They're the people who are carrying on this business of money laundering. They are the people who are motivating the general public in Pakistan and those people across in Afghanistan for jihad. They call it jihad, to go and support your brothers in Kashmir, the Muslims in Kashmir, so that we can get Kashmir back. And Kashmir is our, is for us Muslims. The Pakistani army also feels that what else is left to fight India? What else can they fight for? They also have to survive. So for them, Kashmir is an important issue to keep Kashmir burning, to keep it on the boil. So these, all these three things that are required, that is manpower, that militants, money to facilitate, to get them weapons, to get them all these other things, and training. So all the government of Pakistan and the Maulvis, these mullahs, these terrorist leaders are all involved. They're all the same.
Hafiz Saeed has been declared a global terrorist by the US and UN after 2008 attacks. But this does not seem to affect Pakistan in any manner. Even after being lodged in jail, Hafiz Saeed continues to lead same comfortable life. Saeed in Pakistan delivered anti-India speeches just like any common political leader. In a speech delivered few months back, Hafiz Saeed was heard saying that the war against India won't be fought at the borders but in the Indian cities across the country. In spite of issuing direct threats to India, there was no coercive action taken against Saeed after this speech or any other speeches delivered before.
Even though Hafiz Saeed was in jail and he's politically active, because he's the man and people like him who can motivate all the people who are simple, who are illiterate, who are uneducated. There is lawlessness in Pakistan, so these people easily get motivated for jihad. They are groomed right from childhood in their madrasas. They're trained, they're told that bhai, raj hum nahi karna hai, musalmano nahi karna hai Kashmir.
Also, Hafiz Saeed enjoys the designation of a columnist too in Pakistan, as he has previously contributed his articles in mainstream newspapers of Pakistan. Pakistani terrorism has become a global truth. It is known all over the world that Pakistan not only provides resources and funds to terrorism, but also trains and shelters some of the world's most dreaded terrorists.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@anin.com. This is Surbhi Sharma signing off on the behalf of the entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.
You're watching TAG TV.